Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Amen. We continue on page 4 in your service guides. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, you have made us for yourself, and our hearts are restless until they rest in you. Look with compassion upon the heartfelt desires of your servants and purify our disordered affections, that we may behold your eternal glory in the face of Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. Precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes.
More to
be desired are they than gold, even much fine gold, sweeter also than honey and drippings of the honeycomb.
Lord, may only your word be spoken and only your word heard. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Good morning. It's good to be back with you again this morning and sharing the word. This morning, I'd like to look at today's gospel, which is found in John chapter 2, and it's Jesus cleansing the temple. As we're in the midst of our Lenten journey, I hope you are all having a Holy Lent and haven't failed too badly, as I have, but God's mercies are new every morning. So we keep on with this journey of Lent. And one of the things that I'm observing during Lent is I'm reading The Celebration of Discipline by Foster, where he talks about various Christian disciplines. And one of the spiritual disciplines is meditation. And Foster is very clear to point out that most Christians shudder at the word meditation because they think of Eastern meditation. In Eastern meditation, the point is to drain your mind, to empty your mind. But that's not Christian meditation. In Christian meditation, we fill our minds by meditating upon the Word of God. And one of the disciplines that Foster brings out is what he calls the sanctified imagination. That is to take a portion of Scripture and pause and meditate on it and begin to imagine it, what it looked like. I always tell people, sometimes it's good when you're reading, especially the Gospels, to pretend that you're a director of a movie. Maybe you're directing The Chosen. How would you depict it? How would you view it? What do you see? And so today I'd like us to do this with the cleansing of the temple. And I'm hoping that maybe you can actually take this home with you and spend some time in your own Lenten devotion meditating upon the Word of God. So I'd like you to picture the temple in Jerusalem. If you've been to Jerusalem, you've probably, I never have, but you've probably been to Temple Mount. If not, you've seen pictures. And the most prominent building in those pictures is actually a Muslim mosque called the Dome of the Rock, or the Al-Aqsa Mosque. And it's that great gold dome that you always see in pictures of Jerusalem. That mosque is built on Temple Mount, where the temple used to be. The temple, of course, was destroyed in 70 AD by Vespasian and his son Titus of Rome. And it, you know, even though Zionists would love to rebuild the temple, they can't because the Dome of the Rock is there. But if we go back to the first century and begin to imagine the Jewish temple, the very center of Israel, the very center of Jerusalem, up on that hill, that focal point, was the great temple. At Jesus' time, it would be called the Herod's temple, and it was the focus, the center, the life of Jerusalem. And it was made up of six different, I don't think the word's concentric because they weren't round, but six different rectangular sections getting smaller as you get into the center. So the largest area was just an open area called the Court of the Gentiles. The Court of the Gentiles was an area where anyone could go. It was huge. Gentiles and Jews alike could mill around the outside of the temple. And this is probably where the cleansing of the temple takes place. This area had a small railing around it that it was very clear with signs telling any Gentiles that if you crossed over this point, it was punishable by death. In fact, you may remember at the end of the book of Acts when they tried to kill St. Paul, it was because they thought he brought Gentiles into the temple. But they were allowed on that outside area, the court of the Gentiles. Then as you went into the compound, there was an open area called the women's court. It was men and women were there, Jewish men and women, but women were allowed in there, and that's probably where Jesus was dedicated. From there, you went into a smaller area called the Court of Israel, which is where the Jewish men could go in. And beyond that was a court of the priests, where the priests did their work. The sacrifices took place, the washings. And the men could see all the work that the priests were doing. But beyond that was the actual building of the temple. First, an area called the Holy Place, and then beyond that, an area called the Holy of Holies. Those two areas, only the priests could go into the Holy Place. That's where Zechariah was offering incense when the angel Gabriel appeared to him and told him that John the Baptist was going to be born. But beyond that, you could see, but you could not enter the Holy Place. You could see a veil, a curtain. This curtain that divided the Holy Place from the Holy of Holies was the width of a man's hand. That's how thick this curtain was. Massive, huge curtain. And you could not see into that little room where the Ark of the Covenant was, and above it, the mercy seat. Only the high priest, one person, the high priest, could enter that Holy of Holies, and that only once a year on the Day of Atonement. And so anyone else that would go in there, it was instant death. The high priest would go in and sprinkle the blood of Yom Kippur on the mercy seat above the Ark of the Covenant. But on occasions you could see that curtain, but you could not see into the Holy of Holies. And so imagine that. Begin to picture that in your mind. And outside in that court of the Gentiles, where anyone could come and worship, everyone was invited to come worship and participate in the temple, but the Gentiles could go no further. But there they began to hold what probably was like a three-ring circus. And everyone started making money. The Roman coins of the time, and of course the Romans were hated, and so the Roman coins were a mixture of money, of metals. They weren't pure. There was a more pure coin minted in Tyre, which was 99% silver. And so when Tyre was no longer allowed to mint their own money, the Jews in the temple were permitted by the Romans to mint those Tyre silver coins that were pure, and those were used in the temple. They didn't want impure Roman coins. And so you had to take your Roman money and exchange it for these silver coins. Those silver coins of Tyre are probably what they paid Judas with, the 30 pieces of silver. Well, the problem was, of course, that they were marking up their money changing. And you're supposed to bring the best of your flock to be sacrificed, but it was easier to go up to the temple and just buy livestock. So there's all this commerce going on in the area where the Gentiles are supposed to be worshiping. And it's here that Jesus cleanses the temple. He makes a rope whip. He begins whipping people. He begins turning over tables. He just goes crazy, you know, this picture of him, this image of him throwing out these people. And nobody dares to stop him because he's right. He says, quoting the Old Testament, he quotes two places, "This my house is to be a house of prayer for all nations, and you have made it a den of thieves or a den of robbers." The word nations, when we hear the word nations, we sometimes think of those boundaries, those geopolitical boundaries we think of today. Germany is a nation, France is a nation, Spain is a nation. But in the original Greek language of the Bible, the word is actually ethnos, from which we get ethnicity. It's not nations like, you know, because there weren't nations, there were empires. It's nations don't really rise until the Middle Ages, but what it's talking about is people, ethnos. To the Jews, ethnos meant the Gentiles, everybody else. So Jesus is saying, my house is to be a house of prayer for all the people, even the Gentiles. They may not be able to come inside at this point, but they can still come and worship. But you've turned it into a den of thieves. And this story is important. It's so important that it's mentioned in all four of the Gospels. It's mentioned in the three Synoptic Gospels, and then John mentions it as well. So all Scripture is important, but when it's repeated like that, you know it's very, very important. The Synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, see the story one way. John sees it a little bit differently, but it's telling the same story about Jesus cleansing this temple. And when you see Jesus, you know, we think of Jesus as, you know, gentle Jesus, meek and mild. Gentle Jesus smiling and loving people and feeding the 5,000. And here we see a picture of Jesus, the man, just going berserk in the temple, whipping people and turning over tables, money, these silver coins going everywhere. Just imagine the rage, the confusion, the, you know, what's going on here? And you might be tempted to say, well, Jesus lost it. You know, Jesus just went crazy. He lost it. You know, that, and you say he never sinned, but look at the anger. You know, look at the angst. Look at the rage that's going on. No, Jesus didn't lose it. Jesus had what we call righteous indignation. His anger is always directed towards, as is God's throughout the Old Testament, is always directed at injustice and religious hypocrisy. In Mark chapter 3 and verse 4, Jesus goes to heal someone on the Sabbath day, the man with the withered hand. You may remember the story. And they want to stop him, the religious leaders, because it's the Sabbath. And it says, he looked around at them with anger. He looked around with them with anger, grieved at the hardness of his heart, and then he healed the man with the withered hand. Use that meditation technique to try to picture that. What does it look like for Jesus to have this complete compassion and love for this man with the withered hand, while at the same moment looking at them with anger? Picture that in your mind. Meditate on it tonight or sometime this week. What does it look like to have both love and anger at the exact same time? Even his own disciples, when the people brought the children to him to bless and the disciples tried to stop it, it says that he was indignant with his disciples. And he said, let the children come to me. There was righteous indignation. That's pretty different from what we experience, isn't it? Friday night, we were going to Ian and Kendra's house. We're going right out of our area. We're trying to get on 70, and we have an accident. And it was Oliver's 9th birthday, and we have this. It was pretty bad, but nobody's hurt. It was, you know, pretty bad damage. But as this guy made a right turn from the left lane into me, I go, what are you doing? And, you know, the windows were rolled up, thankfully. And afterwards, Gwen says, wow, you were really mad. Now, when we got out, we were fine. Everybody was nice. It was a very polite exchange, you know, and thank goodness it was, because it turns out he lives right nearby, you know. But she goes, I wasn't mad. She goes, well, you said that with clenched teeth. And I said, yeah, but I didn't cuss. That's got to count for something. And of course, my daughter immediately reminded me of a time when they were little and I was taking our youth group to Six Flags, or some of the girls from church. And we lived in Baltimore City with parallel parking. And we had a card table in the back of the minivan, and it was blocking half the window. And I put it in reverse, crash right into the car that was parked behind me. And I go, darn it. But I didn't say darn. I said that thing that holds back water. And it's dead silence. And I hear this little voice go, Father Eppard. I'm like, oh. Which is worse, hitting the car or the priest saying the bad word, you know? But so we get anger, but it's not always righteous indignation. You know, we have to check ourselves and ask, why are we angry? Where are we getting this anger? Where is it coming from? But we can be like Jesus. We can be angry. There is such a thing as righteous indignation. Ephesians 4:26 says, be angry and sin not. So you can be angry and not sin. We should hate sin. We should be angry with injustice. Someone asked me recently, where is it in the Bible that it says, hate the sin but love the sinner? It's not. It's a popular saying, but it's not in the Bible. But there's truth to it, isn't there? We should be angry with sin. We should be angry with those things that God is angry with. And he is angry with sin. Throughout the scripture, you'll find his wrath directed at sin and injustice. And so, anger is not in itself a sin. Jesus did not sin when he became angry with these people. He was grieved in his heart. Now, something happened. I want to go back to the temple for just a minute. Something happened on Good Friday, which we will be observing in just a couple weeks. Something happened that was earth-shattering, amazing, unheard of in the history of the world before Good Friday or after Good Friday. It's recorded in Matthew 27, verse 5. And that is that when Jesus died, that curtain that I spoke of, that curtain that divided the holy place from the holy of holies, that curtain that was as thick as a man's hand, was suddenly, miraculously torn in two from the top down to the bottom. Behind that curtain, in that holy of holies, was the manifest presence of God in the earth. The Holy Spirit chose to dwell there. We called it the Shekinah glory of God. Dwelt in that holy of holies. And when Jesus died, that curtain was ripped apart by God from the top to the bottom, signifying from heaven to earth. And suddenly, anyone there could look and see right inside of the Holy of Holies. Why? Because God's presence was no longer there. God's presence, his Holy Spirit, went out from that place and on the day of Pentecost was poured out upon the apostles and all of the disciples and all of the people right down to our present day. And Paul explains this to us in 1 Corinthians. Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 3:16, and then again in 6:19. So again, it's repeated. It's important. And he makes this radical, radical statement for a Jewish rabbi to make. He says, do you not know that you are God's temple and God's Spirit dwells in you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him, for God's temple is holy, and you are that temple. In chapter 6, he says, or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God? You are not your own, for you were bought with a price. So glorify God in your body. Think about that. Imagine that. Meditate upon that. That this once all-important building that housed the manifest presence of God, the Shekinah glory of the Holy Spirit, is now empty in Jerusalem. And that same power that raised Christ from the dead, Paul says, now dwells in you and in me. and you are the temple of the Holy Spirit. You carry within you the Holy Spirit of God, the Shekinah glory of God. Now let's go back to anger. Now let's go back to anger for just a minute. With whom are you angry? Religious leaders? Oh, those darn Episcopalians. Those, you know, what they're doing to that church. Or those Lutherans. I one time went to look at a church building to buy it, and I met this Lutheran bishop, and he's showing me the building to buy it. And we get to talking, and we knew a lot of the same people. We had been in the same, I had looked at being ordained in the Lutheran Brethren Church, and he knew the people that I knew and so forth. And I said, well, what kind of Lutheran are you? And he says, the bad one. And I knew, and he knew I knew, that he meant ELCA, the liberal one. And we laughed. It was funny. You know, the bad one. You know, you could say, well, I'm mad at those, you know, darn liberal theologians or I'm mad at these religious people or these politicians. You know, I watch this entertainment news network or I watch this entertainment news network and I think it's actually serious and I get all enraged and, you know, I get all upset with the politicians or I'm mad at somebody else that did something in my family or my neighborhood. Who are we angry with? And then we have to remember the words of Jesus. Now this is where it gets a little hard, so I'm preaching to myself. That makes it easier, and you can listen in. Remember the words of Jesus. Judge not, lest you be judged. And then when Jesus said, don't try to take a speck out of your neighbor's eye when you've got a plank stuck in your own eye. Think about that for just a minute. And begin to ask yourself, if I am the temple of the Holy Spirit, what money changers and livestock merchants have snuck into my temple? What has come into my temple that has defiled it? God said to Cain, sin is crouching at the door. We heard from Paul this morning in chapter 7 of Romans that we desire to do one thing, but we always end up doing the same, the wrong thing. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Sin is always crouching at the door. And so we are called to cleanse the temple of our own lives. That's what Lent is all about. In the Old Testament, again and again and again, God says, sanctify yourself, be holy, for I, the Lord, am holy. Paul says in Romans 12:1, I beseech you, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice to the Lord, holy and acceptable, which is your reasonable service. You are called to cleanse yourself. James says this in chapter 4 and verse 8. Draw near to God and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Be wretched and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves before the Lord and he will lift you up. In this Lenten season, we need to take a good, hard look, a meditative, sanctified imagination look at our own temple. Reimagine Jesus cleansing the temple in Jerusalem. And then take some time this week to reimagine Jesus cleansing your temple, the temple of your life, the temple of your body, the temple of my life. Probably not livestock merchants and money changers, but maybe it's addiction. Maybe the Lord wants to take a rope, whip, and drive out the drugs or the food or the alcohol or the pornography, the gossip. Maybe he wants to drive out from us that social media that we scroll through for hours on end, or watching those entertainment news networks, not realizing that they're trying to gin it up and make you angry. Maybe he wants to take us from a place of sloth or greed or lust or envy or whatever it is. I don't know. You have to sit there and imagine it. You have to close your eyes and try to picture the outer court of your own temple. And you have to say, Lord, come. Lord Jesus, take a whip if you have to. Turn the tables over. Turn my life upside down this Lent so that come Easter, I can live in the power of your resurrection. That's my prayer. Cleanse my temple. And I hope today that you'll take something with you, that this week you can spend some time in quiet prayer and say, Lord Jesus, I open the door of my temple. Come, come, drive out from me anything that is not of you. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.
now in the presence of our infinitely holy God, please join me at page 130 as we confess our sins. We pray together, most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart, not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We're truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who in his great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all those who sincerely repent and with true faith turn to him, may he have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the word of God to all who truly turn to him. The saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. My friends, will you please stand and greet one another, exchanging the peace of the Lord. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Spirit. Thanks, buddy. Bless you. Folks, good morning. We have a few announcements that we'd need to get to this morning. That's a good word, brother. Thank you. I appreciate that. Oh, absolutely. Yep. Just a few announcements before we come to the Lord's table together. And Lori, you're going to be up here in just a moment. And we're grateful for Carol and Priscilla, their team pulling together these breakfasts before the services. Grateful for that. And the quality is superb. So I want to encourage you to come out for these. Then on Tuesday at 10, we have our Lenten services, Tuesday at 10 in the side chapel here. I'm going to ask Martin to speak in just a moment or two about the first Wednesday that we have coming up this Wednesday. And other announcements in the bulletin I'll let you consider on your own. Important one regarding the Coastal Pregnancy Care Center's annual fundraising banquet. I'm excited this week for a few things that are coming up. I'm going to be flying to Kansas City on Wednesday as a part of the Made to Flourish residency program that we have entered into. This is the group that has extended a grant to us for $150,000 over the next 5 years, so that as Chris Lee leaves All Saints and makes his way fully down to Swansboro with St. Christopher's, we'll be able to then bring in the next Chris Lee, although there's only one, but the next church planter or pastor that we'll raise up here, give some opportunity for experience, learning, and teaching, and then send them out. And our goal is that we would just do this then forever, as long as there's an All Saints. So I really do covet your prayers. As we go and collaborate together. And then also, we are in the process now of beginning to recruit that next person coming in. So I covet your prayers with that process as well. Over the weekend, we had a wonderful gathering of the four churches in our deanery, and able to hear what's going on throughout the rest of our region here. And just a lot of good things happening in the church here, but then also around it. And I want to have Lori now speak to an opportunity that the Lord seems to be renewing and refreshing for us regarding our music program here at 9 a.m. Lori?
All of you for the choir.
Not all of them.
Maybe not all of you. Several of us here at All Saints are being led by the Holy Spirit to reform a choir to help lead music and worship. Psalm 100 verse 2 tells us to make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all the earth. Make a loud noise and rejoice and sing praise. One of the key words in this scripture is joyful. As followers of Christ, we have a responsibility to share with others the joy that comes from having a personal relationship with Him. And I don't know about you, but I can't think of any better way to express joy than through music and praise. I mean, that's what music and praise is joy. Music is a universal language that speaks to everyone. It conveys our deepest emotions in a beautiful way. And what's really most important is that when we sing praise to God, He is glorified and He's pleased with our efforts. In Revelation 7, verses 9 and 10, the Apostle John describes a glimpse of eternity where he sees a great multitude that no one could count from every nation, tribe, people, and language standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands. And they sang in a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." This view of heaven clearly shows us that God is pleased by songs of praise. So that's why we should make music for God, because it pleases Him and it glorifies Him. But you might be thinking at this point that you don't have time to be part of a choir, and I completely understand that. When I started my career as a church musician in 1991, I had a baby who was less than a year old and a relatively new business, and those two things took pretty much all of my time. I was asked by my church to take the pianist position, but I resisted for months, doubting that I had the time it would take to do the job right. But as so often is the case, God would not leave me alone about it. And finally, after 3 months of wrestling with God, I gave in and somewhat begrudgingly prayed, "Okay, God, your will be done, not mine. I will give you my best efforts, but you know how little free time I have. So I'm going to need you to step in when my best efforts aren't enough." And you know what? He's never once let me down. He's been my hands more times than I can count, especially when I've been too busy to prepare and practice as much as I would like to do. Currently, at this present day, after 4 eye surgeries and 2 laser procedures, I'm still blind in my left eye. And I have moments of absolute and complete terror at the piano sometimes. I'm struck by the worry that I'm going to be making a lot of mistakes because I can't see things clearly. And if I just stop and take a breath, I'm reminded who my Father is and that He's never failed me before, and He's not going to start today. I lose my doubt and know that He will be my eyes. And when I make mistakes, it's okay, I'm human. And I'm not even close to perfect. So there were always going to be mistakes. Another obstacle that you might be thinking about is that you're not qualified. However, you've got to remember this old saying, God doesn't call the equipped. He equips the called. And the funny thing is that, you know, God doesn't even call you because He needs you. How many of you did He consult with when He created the universe? Did He need any help from any of you? He didn't ask me. He did that all on His own. He doesn't need you. He calls you because He wants to bless you. The joy that I've gotten from being able to praise God with music over the years far outweighs any joy that I might have been able to bring to other people. If you're feeling a nudge at this point but still doubting, please prayerfully consider if God is guiding you to be a part of this new worship effort. Ms. Frances Nance, right over here, who is an excellent vocal coach, and choral director as well, as she has a beautiful soprano voice. She and I will be leading the new choir, and we will meet on Sunday mornings after the 9 a.m. service in a room here at the church, still to be determined. But that means you don't even have to give up an extra night during the week. You just have to stay a little bit longer on Sundays. If you have kids, there is a nursery during the 10:30 service when we will be practicing. The choir will start with practicing familiar hymns and hopefully work our way up to preparing full anthems in the future. If you're willing to help lead service music by singing in the choir, please let me know, or you can call the church office and leave your name and contact information. And I look forward to making beautiful music as an offering to our Lord.
Thank you, Lord. So I want to, as Martin makes his way forward, I want to pray, Lord God, will you please now do your work by your Holy Spirit of moving us in the directions that you would have us serve. And we make a special, specific appeal this morning, Lord God, that your Spirit would draw out those who would come and sing and offer their voices, offer their lives, their worship as an expression of their gratitude for your love and salvation. In Jesus' name, amen. Martin.
Time for a second sermon?
No.
I just wanted to put in a plug for First Wednesday. Last month was great. We had food at the potluck from Southern cooking to India. And so there's not many people signed up yet. So if you sign up for the potluck supper, and what I'm going to teach on this Wednesday is going to be what Christians believe about Holy Communion. So if you've ever wondered what all the different churches believe, and why they believe slightly differently, like what do the Baptists believe, what do the Catholics believe, I'm going to go over all of that and how we got there and what the Anglicans believe about Holy Communion. So it actually would be a good thing to invite your friends. I promise not to insult them, but if you can bring your friends, your neighbors, it'll be a good time, good meal, and hopefully you'll learn something about all the different interpretations of the Lord's Supper. I hope to see you there this Wednesday at First Wednesday.
Thank you. And now we do come to the table, and we will celebrate the Holy Communion together. If you would prefer to sip from the cup as you come forward, please go to your left side of the rail. At the right side, you'll be handed a wafer that has been dipped in the wine. Also to the right side as you're facing forward, gluten-free wafers and non-alcoholic wine will be provided. Now will you please stand as the gifts are presented and we sing together the doxology. We continue on page 132 in the Red Book of Common Prayer. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right in our duty and joy always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, as you bid your faithful people cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that fervent in prayer and in works of mercy and renewed by your word and sacraments, they may come to the fullness of grace which you have prepared for those who love you. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself, and when we'd sinned against you and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent your only Son, Jesus Christ, into the world for our salvation. By the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, he became flesh and dwelt among us, and in obedience to your will, he stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself once for all, that by his suffering and death we might be saved. By his resurrection, he broke the bonds of death, trampling hell and Satan under his feet. And as our great high priest, he ascended to your right hand in glory that we might come with confidence before the throne of grace. On the night that he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, our Lord took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith, that Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, and we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your word and Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. And sanctify us also, that we may worthily receive this holy sacrament and be made one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him. And in the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us with all your saints into the joy of your heavenly kingdom, where we shall see our Lord face to face. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Continuing, we do not presume to come to this your table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your abundant and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord whose character is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. My friends, these are all the gifts of God for the people of God. Come, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. We close in prayer this morning on page 137 in the prayer book. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you've given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. And now receive this blessing from the 13th chapter of the letter to the Hebrews. May the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, that great shepherd of the sheep, equip you with every good thing for doing his will, and may he work in us what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. The blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you this day and remain with you always. Amen. Please stand.
Peace, to love and serve the Lord.